In this video, we will script radare2 in Python with our two pipe to extract the encrypted code and recover the flag. Last video, we reverse engineered the algorithm that is used to verify the input key, the flag, with Binary Ninja and GDB. The challenge is called Zwiebel from the TUMCTF 2016, and that's the German name for onion. We learned that the binary will decrypt itself layer for layer and check different bits of the input during each step. Now we want to create an automated script that performs a tedious reverse engineering task for us. First, make sure that your radare installation is up to date. Always work with the repository and not install it from a package manager. Then simply run sys install sh, which will update to the latest commit. And make sure you have r2 pipe for Python installed. Now we can access radare from Python. The API is super simple. After opening a file, you simply execute commands as you would with radare command line. So let's get started. Open the binary with radare2. Then use doo, which reopens the binary in debugging mode. Then I take the address of the call r14 and set a breakpoint with db. With dc, we can continue the process execution, which will ask for the input key. After that, we hit the breakpoint. Now, let's do the same in our script. First, we need to import r2 pipe, and then we can open the executable with radare. And then we can simply execute those commands with the cmd function. It's that easy. Here's what I try to do. I will write the script here, and in the small window I try to show you the radare command descriptions and what it does. Then I hope it's easier to follow. So the first command was doo, which reopens the binary in debug mode. After that, we want to add the first breakpoint, which is db. Then we continue the process with dc, which should hit the breakpoint. At this point, we should be just about to execute the call to r14, which is the actual code doing the checks and the decryption loops. So we want to do a step forward of one instruction into that code. I think we will step a few times, so let's define a helper function step, which will execute ds, which is a single step. And when you execute a single step, then obviously the instruction pointer of the CPU moves on. But the current address of radare does not update. So we want to also seek to this new address. We can use srrip, which will seek to the value of the register rip. Cool, we will use that function in a moment. So now we can start writing the loop that will perform the same steps over and over again. So our first step is to extract the current bit checking rule. How does this look like? We can scroll back up there where we looked at this in GDB and look at how this looked like in assembler. So we are somewhere before this code, and what we want to is now extract all those lines of assembler until we reach this jump equal. So we would define a list this as, which will hold each line. Then we do the following loop. We first step one instruction forward and then use pd, which prints the disassembly of one instruction at the current address of radare. That's why we seek to rip in the step function. But actually we will do pdj, because that outputs JSON information instead of just a text line. And in Python, we can call this now with cmdj, which will automatically return a Python dict to easily access this JSON data. Let's quickly see if our script works by opening a Python shell and copy the code. Looks pretty good, or nope, somehow it all hangs. We kind of forgot to handle the input. The process is currently waiting for a key which we can't enter. I started to Google a bit and found this. So I created a rarun profile that specifies that the process shall receive this string as input. We can set this profile through radare's environment variables. So we add this command to our script. Then we can try it again to run, and indeed, it now proceeds at the breakpoint after the key input is hit. Now let's continue with the script. Let's add the current instruction opcode to the list. PDJ returns a list of instructions, so we get the first element. And then we get the opcode value of the dictionary. Then we also check if the instruction type is a conditional jump, C jump. If that is the case, we reach the jump equal. This means we reach the end. If the bit check was okay, it will continue the decrypt loop afterwards. This means after we break out of this loop, we have a list of instructions, and the last one is the jump equal. The one before is the binary value, and the one before that is the move that gets the character at a certain offset. So this first instruction is the character offset. The syntax of the move opcode has the offset plus something after RAX. So this is actually Python, but it gets the job done. We split the string at RAX, and the second element of the result, minus the last character, is our offset value as a hex string. Now, sometimes the first character is referenced, then it doesn't have a plus hex 0, so if we got an empty string, we simply set the offset by hand to 0. Then we can convert the hex offset value to an integer number. Next instruction is the binary AND value, which will tell us which bit is checked. Similarly, like before, we can take the opcode string and split after the comma. And that is the hex value, which we can convert to an integer. Cool. One more thing we need now is a variable to build our flag. I'd suggest we simply make a long list of numbers, which we then can add single bit informations that we extract to. I initialize it to hex 20, which is the ASCII space. So once we got this info, we can simply update the flag at the offset and set this particular byte with a binary OR operation. After that, we can write some code to print the current state of the flag. We loop over each number. If it's between a certain printable ASCII range, we convert it to the ASCII character. Otherwise, we append a space to the output. With sysstdout_write, we can directly write to the output because Python print appends a new line. This way we can use \r instead, which makes the script look really cool. The next step in our script will be to perform the decryption. If you remember, after the loop instruction, we have the jump into the decrypted code. So we could simply perform single steps forward and check after each step if the opcode of the current instruction is loop. And if we found the loop instruction, we can stop. The instruction afterwards is the jump, so we can use pdj2 to get the current and the next instruction. And from the next instruction, we can take the address where it wants to jump to. We can extract that value easily thanks to the JSON data, and then add a breakpoint at this new address. Next, we simply continue. I think we are basically done. Let's test it. No syntax errors, but something else seems wrong. It stops way too quickly after only a few rounds. Let's add some debugging output that displays us some of the instructions. When we run it now, we get the instruction that check the bits, and when you look closely, you can see that it's not always jump equal. There are actually some jump not equal. So that is the inverse of the check we know. The normal one, checked if a character has a certain bit set to 1, the jump not equal check will make sure that a certain bit is not set, so it's 0. And we don't have that logic yet. Let's write that code. We can simply check the last opcode if the jump was jump equal and then set the bit to 1 with the binary OR that we already know. Or if we have a jump not equal, we set the bit in the flag to 0. That's a bit more tricky, but basically you use a binary AND with a bit sequence of all 1s except the one bit you want to set to 0. To get this binary sequence, you can take hex FF, which is all 1s, and XOR it with the bit you want to set to 0. This will produce the bit sequence with that one bit 0. Just play it through on a paper, it becomes clear. But there's another problem, which is our input flag, because we specified in the raw run profile that it's a fixed AAAA string, which will eventually fail the bit checks, and that's the real reason why it stopped. But we could add some code that bypasses this check and always continues to the next layer. These conditional jumps, JE and JNE, are sometimes also called jump if 0 and jump if not 0. The CPU has a register that contains flags, and one of those flags is the 0 flag, which will be 1 if the previous calculation resulted in a 0, and it will be 0 if the result was non-zero. This makes sense because if you want to compare two values, you can simply subtract them from another, and if the result is 0, they were the same, and the 0 flag will be set. This means we always want to make sure the 0 flag is set to 0 or 1, whatever makes sense for the code to continue. We can set those registers in radare2 during debugging with dr and then set zf 0 flag to 0, so the jump equal will not jump, and we can set it to 1 so the jump if not equal will not jump. Oh, and we should remove our debug output. Now let's run it and see what will happen. Radare outputs every time we hit a breakpoint. That's not pretty, but it does it on the standard error output, so we can simply redirect std error to def null. Now we have a very pretty output. The program is running, decrypts each layer, extracts the rules, updates the bits in the flag and displays it to us. It slowly recovers the flag now. Looks so elite. And there we have it. I hope you didn't peel the onion by hand. Awesome.